All right.
Nice pictures.
Okay, so people can see the screen.
Mm-hmm.
I'll take that as a confirmation. Great, okay. Although now I just lost the video of myself.
It's probably, yeah. It's not, you know.
Yeah, I just have to mess with the Zoom. There we go. I got me back. Okay, perfect.
Perfect. So I think it's 2:05. We don't want to be late for somebody who has probably other appointments later. So we have today Dr. Wesley Legant from UNC. And he's actually at the Biomedical Engineering and Pharmacology departments. And he received his Bachelor's of Science from WashU, San Luis, in 2005. Then he did his PhD at UPenn in 2012. Then he worked at the Genelia Farm. Right now, I think it's not called Farm.
It was rebranded a few Genelia. Years ago.
Yes, I remember that. HHMI Genelia campus. In 2017, and where I think he worked with the Nobel awardee, right, Eric Betzig, and they contribute to the new technology development for light sheet, and where they named it, I think, Lattice light sheet. And now in his team at UNC, he aims to develop advanced custom-built optical microscopes and quantitative algorithms to study key aspects of cell migration and gene transcription with single molecule resolution and sensitivity. And he also received numerous awards. So actually his CV would be a good one if you're interested in applying new awards. He got Shell Scholars, he got Bregman Young Investigator, NIH New Innovator, and Packard Fellowship. Actually, these are all top awards for young investigators. And with this, without further ado, I'll turn to Wesley.
Great. Thank you very much, Ahmet. And thanks so much to you and Rong for the introduction. So I will say, I think one of the things I've missed the most in the pandemic is, you know, speaking to myself in my screen. As you can see, I'm calling from my former office and now baby's nursery. So I think if people would like to interrupt me in the middle of the talk, the interactions are some of the things I'm missing the most. So feel free to do so. If people would also like to wait until the end or post things in chat, that's fine too. So without further ado, as Ahmet mentioned, I'm Wesley Legant, assistant professor in both biomedical engineering and in pharmacology. So I have a joint appointment at UNC. And the BME department is actually a joint department, just like it is at Georgia Tech, except that at UNC, it's joint between UNC and NC State because the medical school is at UNC. So I'll talk to you today about some of the work that we've done recently, and I'll start off more with kind of introduction because I recognize this may be a little bit different than a lot of the talks in this series and areas that you all have had. And then I'll touch on some of the recent things we've been working on, sort of a small vignette in my own group in the past year or so. So I will say essentially everything I'm going to talk about today is motivated by frustration that I had in graduate school. So my graduate work was in a different area looking at cell mechanics and migration. And the problem was is that essentially every time I wanted to take an image, I was trying to do everything in three dimensions I was up against the limits of available microscopes. So I would either not be able to see what I wanted to see, or if I could see what I wanted to see, I couldn't see it long enough before the cell would bleach or phototoxicity would cause the cell to round up and essentially die. And so for postdoc, I switched gears and was really inspired by some of the movies and things that I'd seen from Eric Betzig's group at Genelia with light sheet microscopy. So to get into the motivation for light sheet microscopy in general, it's useful to look at where the limitations come from in existing microscopes. And there are a number of reasons for this, but one of the things to think about is, you know, fluorescence microscopy really wasn't widely available or widely used until a few decades ago. And microscopes were developed hundreds and hundreds of years ago. So the core sort of framework for a microscope wasn't developed with fluorescence microscopy in mind at all. And so one of the challenges using wide field or confocal microscopes, which are likely what you're very familiar with, are that energy flux from your illumination, which is what you need to generate the fluorescent emission from the specimen, travels along an optical axis parallel to the objective that you're using for both exciting the specimen and for collecting the emitted fluorescence. And so the challenge with this is that you only actually collect a single plane that's in focus at one time. And that plane, especially with a high numerical aperture objective, is quite thin. So it's, you know, a depth of field for a 1.0 NA lens is around a micron. So you've got a 1 micron of in-focus region here, but your energy flux is illuminating molecules throughout the whole 3D depth of the specimen. And what that means is everything above and below your focal plane is glowing. It's getting excited. It's generating reactive oxygen species that can make the cell sick, and it's photobleaching. And oftentimes it's doing this far away from the focal plane because there's actually an equal amount of energy above and below in every single plane within this 3D specimen. So confocal, which you're likely familiar with, has been the workhorse for 3D microscopy. And the reason for that is because it uses a pinhole to essentially block all of the out-of-focus emission light. But the important thing to think is it doesn't prevent that excitation light from reaching those planes to begin with. You just block the emission light from hitting your detector. So you actually still have all of the photobleaching and phototoxicity problems. You know, by the time you take a Z-stack and image that 10th plane, that plane has already seen an equal amount of energy every single time you've taken one of those 2D images. So it's already seen an equal amount of light 10 times before you actually image it. The trade-off for this, if you were to actually look at this, this is just showing an example of gene-edited cells from the Kierhausen lab that are tagged with AP2, which is an adapter protein for clathrin-coated pits. So every one of these orange spots is a forming clathrin-coated pit that will be internalized and the AP2 will fall off and it will disappear. So, you know, there's nothing sort of mechanically limiting modern microscopes now, like a spinning disc confocal, from imaging very quickly. The challenge is if you image very quickly on a spinning disc confocal, this photobleaching problem really limits the amount of information that you can get. So you can do maybe 20 volumes and then the fluorophores are so bleached that the sample you're looking at is basically gone. The other challenge is not just the photobleaching problem, but it's the fact that on wide field setups, which are much more sensitive than confocal, the molecules above and below your focal plane are actually negatively impacting the in-focus signal you're trying to detect. And that's because all of these molecules are glowing and photons from them are impinging upon your focal plane as an out-of-focus blur that hides the type of signal you're trying to see. So this is actually an example of some work we had done with James Liu back when I was at Genelia, looking at a spheroid of embryonic stem cells, mouse embryonic stem cells, that's tagged for a SOX2 transcription factor by a halo tag. So these are all individual nuclei here. Every one of the nuclei are glowing because they all have the fluorescent protein in them. And we bleach down a single plane in this volume until we have sparse enough signal to do single molecule imaging. The challenge is if we were to look at this in epi illumination, all of the molecules from nuclei above and below our focal plane are still glowing, and that bright signal is completely swamping out the individual molecules we want to see. Whereas with light sheet, if we just illuminate that 2D plane, we prevent any of those molecules outside of that focal plane from glowing, then we can actually detect and track the individual transcription factors diffusing in the nuclei.
Hey, Wes, sorry for interrupting. I think on your screen, seems like you are sharing your Zoom screen problem, but that's still fine. But I think your attendee panel block.
Okay.
Yeah, part of your slides.
Gotcha, thank you for bringing that up. All right, so let me just maybe hide my attendee panel. Does that work?
Or if you can see, you can switch to your PowerPoint
screen. Yes, that will work. All right, is that better?
This is beautiful. It's
okay, perfect. What about, so I just pulled up my own video. Can you all see still just the presentation?
But we can still see your mouse, the attendee panel, although nothing there, but.
All right, let's just hide the attendee panel. You would think after months.
Okay, it's a good now.
This I would get the hang of it, but. Okay, perfect. So thank you for bringing that up. So I would say, so the obvious alternative to all of this is to say, well, let's only illuminate where we're imaging at high resolution information. And so you're likely familiar with TURF microscopy, which gives you outstanding signal to noise and background rejection. But it does this by coupling your illumination to the evanescent field away from a cover slip. And so TURF microscopy is amazing for doing like in vitro single molecule studies, DNA curtains, things like that. It's awesome for looking at the ventral surface of adherent cells, and it's terrible for everything else because it's inherently not a three-dimensional technique. What we work on and what I'll spend essentially all of this talk telling you about is selective plane illumination, which now uses a separate objective to the one that collects the emission from the specimen. And it uses that objective to then illuminate a thin sheet of light within the specimen that is positioned at the same location as your detection focal plane. And this is what I'll term selective plane illumination microscopy or light sheet microscopy. This actually is not a new idea at all. So just a brief history of light sheet microscopy in a few slides. So the very first light sheet microscope is almost 100 years old now. And it was invented by Zsigmondy and Siedenthoff when he was using it to actually look at diffusion and properties of gold colloids. So this is actually an excerpt from the Nobel Prize presentation in 1925 that was awarded to Zsigmondy for the results he had from studying these gold colloids. But just to point out that the principle of the instrument is briefly that the intensely illuminated object, the solution to be examined in this case, is observed by means of a microscope from the side, i.e. vertically to the axis of the incident light beam. So he called this the ultramicroscope because in this case, the background rejection from illuminating from the side allowed him to actually see the scattered light from the gold particles and study their motion. This is actually a model that is in Zeiss's museum of one of the very first light sheet microscopes. And I think what you'll see is this general layout and scheme has hardly changed at all in the past 100 years. So there's a light source, there's beam shaping optics, there's an excitation lens that's 90 degrees to the lens that is used to collect the actual light from the specimen. And then the sample is now in a cuvette here in between these two lenses. So the perhaps astounding thing is that, you know, almost 100 years went by between the original light sheet microscope and when it started to be reintroduced. So there's, you know, a few applications from Voy and Burns when they were actually looking at cochlear hair cell morphology. I believe this actually was in guinea pigs. This is actually one of the also first implementations of optical clearing. So if you're interested in sort of historic microscopy papers, this is a great one to look at. And then about 10 years after that, Fuchs and colleagues developed a microscope to look at microbes swimming in seawater samples. But it really wasn't until about 2004 and 2008 by the Stelzer lab and Tim Hawley at WashU as well as others that light sheet microscopy underwent a resurgence and really development of the field accelerated dramatically. And there were two key developments that, at least in my mind, really spurred the reemergence of light sheet microscopy as a tool. So the first was GFP and its derivatives, which started to become widely available around mid-1990s. So before image living cells was largely limited. So we didn't have ways to tag individual proteins and make all of the reporter cells that we have now. And in that case, you know, things like phototoxicity were less of a concern because we couldn't image the proteins to begin with. And the second was a proliferation of high-speed CCD and CMOS cameras in the early 2000s that were really driven by, you know, iPhones and the cell phone industry. So the things that we use on our microscopes now, the high-speed scientific CMOS cameras are really just essentially your iPhone camera chip with a very nice amplifier and low noise electronics bolted onto it. So now we can image cells, we can tag individual proteins, and we can do live cell imaging. And now we can image them very, very quickly. And we're no longer biologically limited. We're no longer technologically limited in these areas. And so now things like phototoxicity and photobleaching become hugely important. So initially when light sheet microscopy underwent this resurgence, it was focused largely in developmental biology. This is an early paper from MBL, and it was doing things like looking at individual cells across an entire developing Drosophila embryo with, say, a few micron spatial resolution, but sufficient enough to, say, capture all of the mitotic waves throughout this whole 3D specimen and watch as these things develop over time. You know, fast forward, say, 20 years from that now, I just wanted to highlight one of the most recent impressive examples from Katie McDowell and Philip Keller's group at Genelia, sort of where light sheet microscopy, where the pinnacle is now in developmental biology. And this is looking at mouse embryonic development with subcellular resolution now and tracking individual cells throughout space and time. I think what they were managed to do with this is actually build in adaptive microscopy techniques. So you can see that this individual embryo changes scale throughout this developmental process by nearly tenfold. And so the volume you're imaging and sort of the dimensions that you're imaging and capturing need to adjust dynamically over time to the developing embryo. The other key thing that they did is they coupled this with online machine learning tools to really extract information from this. And this is one of the recurring themes that I'll talk about in this presentation as well, is how do you pull information from this? So every one of these glowing spots here now is a cell division event that can be identified by particular cell morphologies in mitosis. And now these are all of the trajectories of migrating cells after every one of those mitotic events. So in theory, what you can do from this is actually back out the entire cellular lineage during development. The other thing that you can do in a larger scale setting is very, very high speed three-dimensional imaging. In this case, one example from Misha Ahrens looking at an entire zebrafish brain and looking for correlated neural activity. So for these type of settings, what you leverage the low phototoxicity, low photobleaching, and very high speed over large volumes to answer these type of questions. Now, actually, what I'll focus on in for the rest of the talk is more of the things that we've worked on, and it's been maybe a split in light sheet microscopy in recent years from the developmental biology applications, and that's light sheet microscopy for specific subcellular imaging or single molecule imaging. And that's sort of the target area for lattice light sheet microscopy as opposed to some of these larger developmental biology systems. So just a little bit of background on this, a conventional epi illumination has no structure to the excitation light at all. Everything glows. So if we had a particular emitter or a single molecule or a probe, as a rough approximation, we can say that that probe emits fluorescence emission essentially in all directions equally. It's actually a dipole, but for the sake of this conversation, let's say it's a spherical propagating wave. Your detection objective captures a certain portion of that light. That's your cone, which determines the numerical aperture of your objective. And that can then be imaged or scanned onto a camera. And because you're only capturing a limited portion of that light, that now gives you your anisotropic axial resolution. So lateral resolution is determined in this particular case by your detection objective. And axial resolution is also determined by your detection objective. Because bring in light through a light sheet objective, and you're to look at this exact same process, instead of having uniform illumination everywhere, you have a structure into your illumination pattern. So you can say everything above and below the light sheet is dark, and only regions within this light sheet are glowing. And so actually an interesting thing happens then. So one thing you can say is, well, certainly you get optical sectioning because nothing above or below your light sheet is glowing, but you also get increased axial resolution when the thickness of this light sheet, which is shown here in red, approaches the thickness of your detection envelope or your depth of field, which is shown here in blue. So in 3D volumetric imaging, then what you get for your axial response is not the blue beam anymore or the blue profile, but it's the product of the red and the blue profiles. So for thin light sheets, what you actually can get is optical sectioning that's equal, optical sectioning and axial resolution that are equal or better to a confocal microscope, but with the sensitivity and parallelizability of a wide field microscope. So it's really the best of both worlds in that setting. And so what we did with lattice light sheet microscopy is we said, well, we don't just have to use, say, uniform Gaussian beams to illuminate this. We can actually structure the light sheets. And so we can play games essentially with how we generate the light sheets and develop light sheets that are optimized for specific types of imaging. So this here is actually raw data from the paper back in 2014. And what you can see here are different axial profiles of light sheet. So a triangular lattice, a square lattice, and a hexagonal lattice that produce actually point spread functions of varying degrees of out of your products. What you can say is you can develop lattice light sheets that are optimized for reducing background fluorescence and still are closely matched to your detection depth of field. This gives you essentially no out of focus background and increased axial resolution. Or you can develop things like a hexenter node itself is actually very, very small. And if you couple this now with your depth of field, you can match these so that these out-of-focus side lobes are suppressed and you get very, very high axial resolution through these customized type of light sheets. The other advantage with lattice light sheet as it is this is essentially a coherent structured array of illumination, and that is exactly what one would need for super resolution structured illumination microscopy. So we can either dither these light sheets side to side to create a uniform plane of fluorescence, or we can step them and acquire images at every individual light sheet position as we're doing here. And that now is the raw data for structured illumination microscopy. So what that does is it gives us increased axial resolution via super resolution SIM, increase optical sectioning. And here you can see just a comparison of super resolution SIM on the right. This is looking at filopodia of a Lifax stained HeLa cell in the dithered, which is higher speed, but lower resolution versus the structured illumination microscopy data set, which provides higher resolution. Okay, so in this setting, what you can say is, well, let's take this to its logical extreme. You just told us that the axial resolution is determined in this case by the thickness of the light sheet. So if we make the light sheet as thin as possible, then we can get axial resolution that is as high as possible. And that's actually true, but the trade-off with that is, there's always a trade-off between the amount of confinement in your light sheet and the length that light sheet will propagate to provide a uniform field of view. And that's something called the Rayleigh range of Gaussian beams, which essentially says that only in this thin beam waste section here do you have a well-confined sheet. But outside of that, your sheet gets thicker and thicker and thicker, and then that reduces all of the optical sectioning and axial resolution improvement. And this is just due to the physics of how light propagates through space. So there are ways to sort of adapt light sheets to still maintain a very thin axial profile and fit within this Rayleigh range. So one thing is one could do is generate Bessel beams. This was actually one of the original publications back from 2011 that caught my eye and really motivated me to get into light sheet microscopy. And that's that if instead of uniformly illuminating the rear aperture of your excitation lens with a Gaussian profile, which you can see here, if you want a 1 micron thick Gaussian beam, that light sheet will be about 10 microns long. So it's a very, very short field of view. In contrast, if you wanted something like 100 micron field of view, that light sheet then would have to be very, very thick if one were to use Gaussian beams. Alternatively, with a Bessel beam, you can generate a spear of light that is both thin and very, very long. The trade-off with Bessel beams is you have this out-of-focus ring-like illumination, which I don't need to go into too much detail here now. And then the Bessel beam has to be scanned across the specimen. So to counter some of these trade-offs, we developed together in Eric Bex's group with Bijong Chen and Kai Wong, who were some of the two co-first authors with me on this paper, lattice light sheet microscopy. This is an image of our early prototype from several years ago. I've got images of our more recent versions now. But the principle of this is to use structured light sheets that are based on optical lattices and use these for high resolution 3D microscopy. So an optical lattice itself is by definition a non-diffracting beam. So what we're looking at here in the pupil plane is essentially the Fourier transform of the sample plane. For the folks of you who come from different fields, basically this would be what you shine into the back of your excitation objective, and this would be what you get out at the sample. So by definition, an optical lattice is an interfering array of points that propagates indefinitely away from your excitation objective and never diffracts. It's essentially a solution to Maxwell's equations that is independent of the direction of propagation. The challenge with this is that would require an infinitely small array of spots here in the back pupil that have infinite energy in them. So one could think if the light sheet never changes and it doesn't change as it propagates, then you would need an infinite amount of energy to generate such a plane. So first, those can't be generated experimentally. The other challenge is that they would be completely useless for microscopy because as you can see in the sample plane, what we have is this propagating array of points and it's not a light sheet at all. It illuminates a whole 3D volume. So what we can do is we can bound this two-dimensional lattice with a Gaussian bounding envelope and we can select out a single period of this lattice that maintains some of the non-diffracting properties while still being very, very thin. So in this case, what we're doing essentially is we can tune the thickness of this Gaussian bounding envelope to still maintain the central node and balance this between high Gaussian bounding envelopes that dramatically reduce background or wider Gaussian bounding envelopes that maintain the thinness of the central node while accepting some side lobe energy. And that's something by a lattice light sheet that you can tune independently to generate light sheets that are both long but maintain almost all of the energy in this central node for high resolution imaging. Okay, so that's sort of the theory and implementation of light sheet microscopy. This is sort of where rubber meets the road. So this is our excitation objective. This is just a zoom up of the excitation objective and detection objective. This is that coherently interfering array of beams coming out of the excitation objective. And right at the focus here of our detection objective is where those rays converge to form a light sheet. Now, if we were to zoom in this and actually look at an individual cell, what that is this is this coherent interfering array of beams that illuminates a single plane of fluorescence within the specimen. And then to acquire a 3D volume, we scan the specimen through this plane and repeat this over time, assemble all of these 2D images now into a 3D volume. So just to show you a side-by-side comparison, this is the exact same cell type that I showed earlier in the presentation. This is the AP2 gene-edited cell expressing this AP2 adapter protein at endogenous levels on the under the native promoter. And on top is that same cell type image with a spinning disc confocal, and on bottom is imaged with lattice light sheet microscopy. So by only illuminating just where we're looking with the high-resolution focal plane, we almost exponentially decrease the amount of light that the sample is exposed to and can image for much, much longer at comparable rates. Alternatively, we can dial back the speed on the light sheet microscope and say, let's match, dial back the speed on a confocal microscope to match the photobleaching rates. And what you can see here is just some work we had done with Alex Ritter and Jennifer Lippincott-Schwartz's group looking at spatiotemporal dynamics of actin retrograde flow in a cytotoxic killer T cell forming an immune synapse in a target cell. Just showing sort of the relative increase in spatiotemporal resolution of the exact same process that one would get if they dialed back a confocal to have the same photo bleaching rates that we can get with the light sheet. Okay, so after sort of building and demonstrating the instrument, fortunately being at Genelia gave us a lot of flexibility in many ways. And so the two efforts where we really focused our time was first to develop a very extensive build documentation for the instrument. So there's full CAD models, there's plans. This is actually instructions, sort of one page of the instructions from a newer instrument that we're building here that has, you know, every single screw down to custom parts and vendors for how they get made and how the whole thing gets assembled. So depending on, you know, your feelings, you could view this as sort of a 1,000-page long Lego instruction manual, and some people may like that and some people might not. But there is sort of a step-by-step guide for how to build these. Genelia also hosted a workshop back in 2016 where we had about 40 groups come, and it was sort of like a cooking show. So we had a lattice light sheet microscope, the particular instrument that we had at Genelia that we had built. We had it aligned. We spent the first day demonstrating how to run the instrument, demonstrating sort of some of the fundamental principles. And then we had like one of the worst sessions in my life where we took off all the lenses. People from the audience came and randomly turned knobs to all different positions. And then we spent the next 4 days essentially building it again and realigning everything from scratch. And so fortunately, Genelia had a videographer who videotaped the entire thing. And so there's about 22 hours now of assembly videos showing how to do all of this alignment and operate the instrument. And there's also now an online user forum of, I think it's maybe 150 different people now who are sort of in different stages and in different areas of this field that are contributing, that can answer questions. The advantage with this is it's allowed over 100 research licenses that are, you know, free access to the documentation to be distributed to many groups throughout the world who are now build at various stages of building their own instruments. And finally, to commercialization of this technology, it's been licensed to Zeiss. It's been sold now as a prototype form or sort of as a post-prototype form by a company called 3i. I will say I have no commercial stake in any of this, so I am not on any commercial investment in any of this, but I just like to see this get into as many hands as possible. The other advantage of being at Genelia is it allows us to work collaboratively with a huge number of groups. And you know, the way we developed this instrument was really working together with biologists from the very early stages and adapting the instrument to meet individual needs. So we were able to look at things from single molecules, in this case, transcription factors diffusing in the nucleus and finding target sites. We could, if we didn't want to look at live cell single molecule imaging, we could also localize these individual molecules as they bind and do high resolution localization microscopy, now in thick 3D volumes like dividing cells. High speed imaging in cells, looking both at cellular migration and cellular mitosis, many different examples of how mitotic spindles form and working with a huge number of collaborators. And then actually moving towards developmental biology, not quite at the scale of the things I had shown you initially, But looking, say, now with subcellular high-resolution information over smaller volumes, but still in these developmental specimens. So one of the challenges with all of this that I'll highlight is, like, what do you do with all the data when you get it? And so to give you some perspective, like, the single molecule imaging we had over a large dividing cell was hundreds of thousands of individual 2D images. It was billions of individual molecules that were localized, and raw data itself was on the order of 3 to 4 terabytes. So we need ways to analyze that. And I would say for things like spots that move, and this may be where it would be very applicable to translating some of this into spatial omics, the transition from 2D to 3D is very easy. So this is just showing some example of adapting some code that was originally developed by Gaudin's Dan users group for tracking microtubule plus tip dynamics in 2D and running this now on 3D light sheet microscopy to map these at different stages in cell division and pull out quantitative differences in growth trajectories and velocities at each of the different stages. So spots are pretty easy to transition from 2D to 3D. What's less easy are looking at things like cell protrusion and cell retraction. So I'll just highlight one example that we've done with Klaus Hahn's group, who's actually my colleague right down the hall in the pharmacology department at Genelia, together with David Adelsonson, who's an applied math at Genelia. So Klaus is developing biosensors based on FRET, which will essentially change their FRET signal dependent on the conformation of a given protein. So he has predominantly targets against GTPases and their GEFs and GAPs. This is just one example looking at active RAC, which is a GTPase that regulates cytoskeletal remodeling and is specifically associated with cell protrusions. So looking at a 2D projection, it's very easy to say, oh, RAC is activated and the cell protrudes forward, or it's low and the cell retracts back. But in 3D, what we can see is these protrusions are actually dynamic ruffles that change over time. And so how do we quantify and map subcellular signaling activity in 4 dimensions over time? And that's really where David Adelsonson has come in. And I should mention Ellen O'Shaughnessy is the research scientist in Klaus's lab who's done all of this data. So David's been developing now software to take our 3D light sheet data, generate thresholds and other methods to essentially generate surface maps of the individual features that we're looking at. You can then look and you can say, well, we want to quantify signal relative to sort of this topographical or contour map of the particular cell. This is actually complicated. So this is sort of an overall global view of the map. If you were to just take one of these single protrusions at a single time point, what you can see is, in this case, RAP1 is actually active mostly on the ventral surface, but it's also active in these individual dorsal ruffles here as well. And you have to really scan through this 3D volume to look at the subcellular distribution. Then the other challenge is that this whole structure is dynamic and changes over space and time. And so really this is requiring the development now of new both computational tools, but also visualization tools to make sense of not just 3D data, but 4D dynamic data. Okay, so I spent most of the earlier portion of this talk really sort of living in this space over here of lattice light sheet microscopy. And I just want to say, in general, any type of microscopy is a trade-off. And so, you know, you can view this as sort of the sample is labeled with something. That something will emit photons, and those photons carry the information about the specimen. And so how you want to distribute those photons is up to you. So you can use more of those photons on a simple thing to say, I want a higher signal to noise image, but then the system's going to bleach faster, and so you won't be able to image for as long. Alternatively, you can split those photons up into super resolution modes like SIM or single molecule imaging, but then it takes more and more photons to generate that high resolution image. The thing I haven't really talked about is what happens if we want to image away from the cover slip and move deeper into 3D specimens. And in that case, the problem is that the photons don't either get out of the specimen because they're scattered due to just changes in refractive index of the specimen, or they do get out of the specimen, but they've been aberrated in such a way that you can no longer detect them as high resolution information. And so that's what I'll focus on briefly for the next couple slides. So this is really part of the next part of this work will pioneer off or piggyback off of some work done by Kai Wong, who was another postdoc at the same time as me and Eric Betzig's group. And he was dealing with this fact of how do we image deeper into things like zebrafish brains, given that the brain itself distorts all of the light coming out of it. And so fortunately, astronomy is faced with some of the same limitations. And so ground-based telescopes, every time they look at, say, Neptune or a galaxy far, far away, light from that particular region of the sky is unperturbed, travels through millions of miles of space, and then it hits Earth's atmosphere, and turbulence and temperature fluctuations in the atmosphere completely scramble it before it's able to get to your ground-based telescope. It's why they built the Hubble Space Telescope to get out of all of this. So fortunately, though, what they can do is they can say, well, if we knew how the atmosphere was perturbing our light from our galaxy far, far away, we might be able to apply a correction to that, either physically or computationally, and fix it. And that's the realm of adaptive optics. So in astronomy, what they do is they take a high-powered laser and they shine it into the stratosphere and excite sodium ions that actually will glow and fluoresce, and it's not fluorescence, they will glow and generate an artificial guide star. So an artificial point of light in the sky that shares the same cone of light from the structure that you're looking to image. And then they can measure how the wavefront from that light has been aberrated before it's hit your detector on your ground-based telescope, and then correct for that with a deformable mirror or other element. So what Kai had done is inspired by some earlier work, he had said, well, let's take a two-photon beam, and because that generates a confined point of light, and use that as a guide star within our 3D specimen. And so by measuring the wavefront that comes off of a single two-photon spot, he can then come in and do two-photon beam scanning around this particular location, correct for aberrations, and then do very deep 3D volumetric imaging, like the movie shown here on a sparsely labeled neuronal population in a zebrafish brain. Now, this gives amazing images. The challenge with this is actually that depending on where you look in the specimen, you need a different correction, because the light is traveling through, say, a blood vessel over here on the left and, say, some other portion of the tissue over here on the right. And it was extremely slow because it's a two-photon point scanning-based image. So this particular movie here, it's a live specimen, but it took about 2 hours to capture the whole 3D volume, just acquiring all of that, all of those points. So shortly before I left Eric's lab, another postdoc, Zhong Li Lu, was saying, how do we apply this now to light sheet microscopy? And what we have to deal with actually are that our detection objective and our light sheet microscope look through two completely separate regions of the specimen. It's like having a telescope in Hawaii and a telescope in Chile. They're looking at the same thing, but they're looking through very different turbulence. So first we have to correct for the aberrations from the two individual paths. The structure itself can cause the light sheet to bend out of focus. And it can also block the light sheet from actually hitting the region we want if it's opaque. But fortunately, he was able to develop add-on modules for the Lattice light sheet microscope prototype that we had earlier that apply these corrections to both individual paths and can then restore full diffraction limited imaging, even deep within specimens. So the advantage of this system was now it was able to take, for example, some of the cell migration work that we had done for cells either on a cover slip or say at the interface or very near the edges of a 3D collagen matrix, and transition this now into in vivo specimens like developing zebrafish. So this is now amoeboid migration, on a cover slip in 2D, in a matrix in 3D, and actually in situ in this interstitial fluid filled pocket in a zebrafish. Okay, so this brings us up to, I think, where we were a few years ago. And as I was transitioning from postdoc to faculty, we were at a point where we were saying, well, what microscope would we want to build? And sort of the cutting edge at that point was a light sheet microscope that could use lattice light sheets to generate structured illumination, that had adaptive optics to correct for sample aberrations. It could do things like high-speed live cell imaging and single-molecule imaging like in situ in embryos. One of the things we realized is that in order to do this, you need lasers and cameras and galvos and lenses. But those are really the core components, and I would say 90% of the cost of any type of microscope one would want to build. So a confocal, an inverted microscope, a SIM microscope, an upright microscope. And we started thinking, well, can we combine these sort of intelligently in a way that will address some of the limitations of our earlier prototype microscope, but also allow us to operate in many different modes. So now these are our excitation and detection objectives. They've been re-engineered to work with a 25 millimeter cover slips. There is an inverted objective over there that you can do, look at the exact same specimen through standard inverted microscopy, do things like 3D structured illumination microscopy, confocal microscopy, two photon microscopy, all through this inverted lens. At the push of a button, we can divert all of that to an upright lens. So now we can do things like adaptive optics, two-photon imaging through cranial windows in mice. We made some tweaks, so we have 7 different laser lines. We can do simultaneous multicolor on 2 different cameras. We have all of the 2 photon optics now for 2 photon microscopy, 2 photon light sheet. Here's our 2 photon laser. And essentially the microscope can switch between all of these modes at the push of a button. And so this is some work that they started sort of the last year of my postdoc at Genelia. We've continued collaborating with them. There are several being built at Genelia, several being built at Berkeley, a few other places, and then in my lab also at UNC. Okay, so just to give you a little bit of perspective on what it's like as a new faculty starting a lab, this is where we were about a year and a half ago with our optics rooms. So we had some new HVAC renovations put in to deal with all of our heating and cooling, optical table installation, getting our new lasers lined up and being very excited in the lab, and then crap, there's a leak in the ceiling. And so covering everything with a tarp and panicking late on Friday night, getting that fixed, taken care of, just some photos of the progressive instrument coming together over time. Now we've got full EHNRA, safety certification. It lives in its own box, and it's been running now for about the last year collecting and streaming data. So I'll just give you 2 little vignettes on some of the things that we're working on in my own group. And then I'll maybe open it up to questions and end a little bit early if there's still time. So I think, and this will be particular interest to the spatial transcriptomics folks, is one of the big challenges with these systems are that they require these dipping lenses that are bulky. In this case, this is our detection objective. This is our excitation objective. This is the inverted objective that looks at the specimen, and the sample lives in between all of these 3 lenses. But these bulky lenses actually sit in the same soup as the specimen itself. So this requires large dipping lenses. The lenses themselves have to have unobstructed optical access to the specimen. So it's very hard to say, put a microfluidic chip in here without blocking the light from one of these 3 lenses. The sample chamber to hold all of this is about 40 mil of liquid, which requires a lot of reagents, and it's also non-sterile. So it's hard to take a sample out of the incubator, image it, put it back in the incubator. And these are all just practical trade-offs that allow you to really operate at the sweet spot of where these objectives are designed to work for light sheet microscopy. So as a simple thing, we had said, well, my PhD was in microfabrication. And so one of the first projects that Reagan Moore, who was my first postdoc in the group, started working on are microfluidic chips that are compatible with light sheet microscopes. So in this case, we have a 25 millimeter cover slip, and we have a thin spacer, and then a polymer film now that we can stretch across this, has inlet and outlet ports. And the advantage with this is we've chosen films and constructed them in such a way that there are minimal aberrations to the light sheet optics. We can control the height just based on how we fabricate things. It takes sort of the volume, say if we're using reagents or probes, down from the full chamber of 40 mil to the 20 microliters that fill the chip. And now this is fully sterile because the optics themselves are completely isolated from the objective. So we can take it on and off the microscope, put it back in the incubator, and everything is completely sterile and separate. And now we're working on, our first design was just, let's get a simple chamber that we can flow in and out reagents. But we can think of things like gradient generation or other ways that we can use microfluidics to perturb cells while they're on the microscope. This is just an example of how the optics actually look. So on the left column here is what it looks like both in wide field and light sheet mode, just on open top glass. So that's sort of our ideal point spread function. And on the right column here is with the chip. So you can see that in the direction of tilt relative to the chip, there's a small amount of shearing. We actually have quantification of this now, and it's like on par with sort of lambda over 5, which is what you would get from kind of like high-grade optical mirrors, just their built-in tolerance already. And then it doesn't affect the light sheet very much because that's lower NA, and so we still get very good optical confinement for light sheet imaging. It's fully compatible with live cells, long-term imaging. So this is all 3D volumetric imaging of cell migration in one of the chips. So every one of these time points now is a full 3D volume. So we can image for hours in this standpoint, or even days, with essentially no issues with having this system on the microscope. The other advantage is we can really preserve reagents. So just doing some live cell single molecule tracking, one of my grad students is working on this in various settings now in the chips, is very beneficial, especially if using things like Genelia floor dyes that we only want to add a small volume to the actual chip and not fill the whole chamber. Same thing with DNA paint probes that will come in and hybridize. We can do super resolution single molecule imaging with this with only a few, say, tens of microliters of reagents. The other thing we're working on actually is how do we target or say point these microscopes where we really want them to image? Because you can imagine sort of the field of view where we look at this high spatiotemporal resolution is say tens of microns, and this now 25 millimeter cover slip has tens of thousands of cells on it. The challenge with this is maybe there's 1% or say maybe there's 0.5% of these tens of thousands of cells that we really want to image. And maybe that changes over time. So one example is where Lightsheet has a huge application is looking at mitosis, because it's inherently a three-dimensional process. And it's extremely sensitive to phototoxicity. One of the challenges with this is, say, finding cells at the right mitotic stage that you actually want to capture your image, and identifying them and imaging them. The other challenge is saying, like, well, what if I wanted, you know, 3D structural illumination microscopy images of anaphase? So now I want cells particularly in anaphase, and I want to, say, capture dynamics with the light sheet microscope over time, but I want a few time points that are very high spatial resolution by a 3D sim. And the microscope can switch between these, but it's extremely challenging, and essentially a user has a hard time monitoring the process and then telling the microscope exactly when to switch. So I have a graduate student in the lab now, Caitlin Heath, who's working on essentially having the microscope enter into a surveillance mode, where through the inverted objective or through the light sheet objective, we can acquire large fields of view very, very quickly, and then couple these with convolutional neural networks to identify specific cell types that, say, are expressing particular levels of a given protein if we're looking at, say, transient expression, or cells in particular mitotic stages, and then we can reprogram the microscope to home in on these so that, say, at the end of a day, we can get, you know, hundreds of movies of cells in anaphase to pull out particular statistics based on that without the user having to sit there for 8 days and actually try to search for them and find them. I think this will also be really important as we move more towards full 3D volumes and trying to identify specific anatomical features that may be in different locations depending on how a particular sample is mounted. So with that, I wanted to make sure I left time for questions. So I'm going to go ahead and stop there. I just want to say I have to thank a really outstanding group of students who Reagan's name got cut off there, and so did Keshev's, but outstanding group of students who have jumped into these projects. I will say one thing you'll notice is we're a lab that's in a joint department. We have both fundamental biology projects, we have technology development projects, and it spans a huge sort of intellectual space. And so these people have really been the brave souls that have jumped in feet first and embraced the chaos in some ways. And they've been able to make a lot of progress, I think, in a lot of different settings. So with that, maybe I'll turn back on my video here, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you all have.
Great, thank you, Wesley. I think this was great. And if you have any questions, please unmute yourself and then feel free to ask.
Hi, thank you, Wesley. It was really both beautiful and very sort of, I learned a lot from it. So thank you for this sort of really good overview. I have a question about your microfluidic system. So just to understand what's going on there, you basically take a microfluidic shape, you just make sure that the plastic film on the top is the right sort of refractive index, but you still dip this whole thing into sort of water.
Yes, that's correct. Okay. Yeah, so the lenses are designed to be dipping lenses with
so
sort of nothing.
So inside a regular dipping, you just put another sort of chamber and you just make sure that the film is whatever material that has the 1.33 refractive index or whatever you need to have there.
Yes, the challenge is
standard sort of microfluidics.
Yes, I would say the challenge is that those particular films are a pain in the neck to work with.
Okay.
So from a fabrication and assembly process, it is nowhere near as easy as, you know, plasma bonding PDMS to glass. And so that was one of the things that we've been really trying to optimize is like, how do you make these so your film doesn't just delaminate over time, and how are they really stable, and, you know, can you load and unload them dozens of times and still have a very, robust structure. But you're right. Yeah, it's a very simple design. You just have a refractive film that separates it from your specimen, and that's the gist.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Wrong, you are muted, I guess.
Yeah, I was talking to myself to turn off the mode. So I also have a question about the microfluidics. So any kind of, you mentioned a refractive thin film. So would it kind of just a standard glass be better, or coarse glass? People can fabricate the the glass microfluidics, if that's actually a better option for you.
Yeah, so the bottom is standard glass. So it's made on just a standard 25 millimeter cover slip. The challenge is the top. So because that's, so the light, so like a normal microscope, you know, the objective comes perpendicular to whatever interface or cover slip is. But if you were to take your cover slip on your microscope and rotate it a few degrees, especially for the high NA lenses, like, you know, if you were to, people don't routinely do point spread function measurements, but take your favorite high NA oil lens or water lens and tilt your cover slip 1 degree and look at the point spread function. It goes bad very, very quickly. And so, you know, in the light sheet system, our especially our high NA detection lens is tilted at 30 degrees relative to the specimen. So glass, this is actually a cropped version, but like your glass point spread function would go from what you have here to looking something like this, because all of your light rays have been sheared by that interface now. So one, it has to be as close to the refractive index of the bulk media that you can, and then you want it to be as thin as possible as well, because it's never perfectly matched.
Right. I've got a quick question. So spatial omics applications wise, there are two questions that I have. One is, would we be able to measure like sequential fish or Merfish type of signatures here by changing the buffers and then get still good data? Right, in 3D, is it possible? And second question is, oh wait, then let's go one by one.
No, either way, so I would say, you know, so my understanding of this is you can do all of your labeling off. So one thing I will say now is, especially with some of the projects that we're doing now, is you can take the same sample, take it off your microscope, put it back on your microscope and be within a few microns of your original position. So in that setting, you could say, let's just take a standard, you know, cover slip. We do all of our labeling off the microscope, the washing and things, and then put that back on. I think the challenge for this a little bit would be, and I forget all the different variants, but I think Merfish is the one that relies on photo bleaching, right? And so we had sort of the same problem with Storm of like, it's hard to get the blinky fluorophores because you can't convert everything to a dark state with your epi illumination. And you know, I think you would run kind of the same problem with bleaching there. So how do you bleach everything to get rid of the first round of signal? Maybe you could do it through the inverted objective, something like that.
Well, there are chemical versions, right?
Yeah, the newer ones you could.
Enzymes or for other reagents.
Yes.
So I think that's probably easier. As long as you have wide field contrast, I think it should work.
Yeah, so I guess I was saying, my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm out of my wheelhouse on that one, but I think originally when you asked about Merfish, that one did use photo bleaching. And then the newer variants and different variants have chemical methods to dissociate, or say dehybridization.
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason we couldn't just do those off scope, put it back on. With the chips, potentially we could do everything on scope and just flow in and flow out.
Yeah, that
could be advantageous. I think the challenge, you're saying you can put it within a couple of microns, but right, the challenge is that you need to call the same molecule across your sort of 24 rounds of imaging, right? So your registration, even if you're off, right, you really need to be sort of at a nanometer, like at a point fraction registration across your stack. Right, that's why on a regular epi, people don't take their sample off and put it back on, right? Because that registration, a couple of microns won't cut it here, right? You really need to be top on, which is actually why sort of people flow in and out on the same without taking it off.
Yeah, I mean, just to give you some perspective on that, as long as you have fiducials on your microscope. I don't think it'll be super resolution imaging, essentially with the same sample in 3D. We've done this with DNA paint as well. So as long as you can get the fiducials there and you can identify the fiducials, those can be registered with nanometer precision. So basically the repeatability of mounting and unmounting the sample just has to be close enough to get you into the same one where you can see your fiducials, and then your imaging, you know, post hoc registers everything based on those. And you can do things like gold nanorods, or we're using now nano diamonds that, you know, are fluorescent and never ever bleach. So I agree, you know, I completely agree. You need the nanometer repeatability to register what you want, but I would say the sort of mechanical repeatability only needs to be good enough to get you back in the same field of view.
Yeah, for sure.
And then the second question that I had was, you know, the single cell field started at 96 cells, and with the fluidics, it went up to 40,000 cells, right? What about the throughput of these type of light sheet systems? Like, can you get to thousands of cells with either live or 3D snapshots? Like, what would be your expectation?
Yeah, so the current system we have now, this was one of the sort of design changes we had done from the initial prototype that we had had, which had a flexor stage that would move the sample that had a limited range. So now we use stage scanning. And so but essentially we're limited by optics to sort of the width of the light sheet, but then the length at which we scan, we could scan the whole, you could basically get like roughly 200 micron by 2 centimeter long soda straws and then tile those across your entire 25 millimeter cover slip. And then it's just however many images it takes you, right? So depending on your step size, and if you want a Nyquist sample, then say you're, you know, a few milliseconds per image, you're probably looking at a couple days of continuous imaging, but then you'll have millions. And that's one of the things we're doing for like for the neural networks, right? So for these things, we just tell the microscope to go image, you know, 30 something thousand fields of view overnight. And then we have all the images to do the annotation on for the machine learning.
I see. That's exciting. And then the 3D, would it adapt?
I'm sorry?
The 3D imaging, would that adapt to the calculation?
So one challenge gets there, and we ran into this a little bit with the DNA paint work, right? Is so the fiducials you can put on your cover slip and have them rigidly embedded, and that's fine. When you start to get further and further away into 3D volume, so one is you're probably going to need the adaptive optics. And so one of the things we're working on now is showing actually how much better adaptive optics make single molecule imaging, even when you get like 50 microns away from a cover slip into something like an organoid. The results there are actually very encouraging. But the other problem is if you're looking at registering like transcriptomics data, you can't embed fiducials within your 3D volume. So then you might want to look at like spatial correlation analysis if you have, you know, a subset of molecules that are relabeled every round and some kind of, we ran into that with the DNA paint. It's like nonlinear warping basically to take our larger 3D volume that may change over time and map it back to a reference structure.
Yeah, that would be great. Because the fly in the old times, the developmental questions, right? We've been looking at these stripes of gene expression using just classical analysis. But if you were to do like Merfish, Sickfish on the fly embryos, right? Or like 3D, you map like hundreds of genes, I think we will answer a lot more questions in 3D.
Yeah, I mean, the other challenge I think, and well, I mean, I'm sure everyone, you already know this, but I didn't appreciate it quite so much as this exponential scale of 3D data over 2D data. and, you know, scaling by N cubed scales a lot faster than N squared. And then, you know, N to the fourth if you've got time in there too. So I think I completely agree with you. I think it's also going to take a lot of just computational back end to start doing thicker and larger specimens. Not that it can't be done. It's going to be some effort.
Exactly. Any other questions? Wrong?
Yeah, I think the strength of your technology is really to look at like live cells, see how they move. But have you done something like a clinical specimen and a kind of patient tissue samples? They're static, but they are very messy. Oftentimes, it has everything in there.
Yeah, so the short answer is no, we haven't. And so, you know, to be honest, I think so there's maybe two parts to that one. One is you know, if you're looking in more clinical settings, throughput. So we can image fast, but there's still sort of the physical mounting, unmounting. It's not like it's a multi-well plate reader or something like that we can just do dozens and dozens of samples on. I would say we have the scale to do those type of things. We just don't have any projects that are focused in those areas. I do know, like, so I haven't, but others in Eric's group, together with Ed Boyden's group, have done, you know, expansion microscopy over these larger scale specimens at super resolution, and they have all of the like pathology-based expansion microscopy, which also clears the tissues, which is really, really nice. And so we could envision this being an imaging approach there. Again, the challenge becomes if every single patient's scan is 10 terabytes of data and impossible to analyze, then there needs to be some kind of balance there, I think.
Yeah, you don't really have to scan the entire kind of histology tissue slide, but the focus region, right? For example, 1 millimeter, that's the sort of the tumor invasion region, right? So if you're particularly interested in that region, you can do it.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. The challenge, I think, is, you know, 1 millimeter cube chopped up into 100 nanometer voxels is still a massive amount.
Still a lot. Okay.
Any other questions? And how about multicolor? Like, what is the limitation in your system? So how many maximum colors you can look at?
Yeah, so I would say one of the limitations on with the original prototype that we used for the lattice light sheet microscope was that every color was done sequentially, and it was just based on how the spatial light modulator we used to generate the patterns for them. This one, we can do 7 simultaneously if we want. So, I mean, there's 7 lasers on the system, so we can do them all simultaneously if we want to. The flip side is we have 2 detectors now, so we can run 2 cameras simultaneously. You can envision, splitting those 2 cameras into 2 each and then doing 4 simultaneously. And I think it's relatively easy to play tricks to do as many simultaneous colors as you want and be limited by the emission spectra. We had a couple papers before combining with hyperspectral unmixing. So then you could uniquely identify individual spectra. This was done with sequential excitation and linear unmixing. For your stuff, if you're talking single spots, there are other ways you can encode it, in frequency space basically and put it through a spectrograph, or you can have sort of chromatic dependent aberrations and parse spectra that way. So I think we can excite as many colors simultaneously as lasers that we have.
Great. I think your platform will be the future of spatial omics to solve some of the imaging challenges.
I think light sheet for sure will be. I think there's every microscope you can optimize for a specific task. And so if we were building a microscope specifically for spatial transcriptomics, I think we would probably change things around a little bit in terms of how we would balance trade-offs different ways, because you're not looking at live cell dynamics that way, and your priorities are maybe a little bit different. I also think in the commercial space there should be things very quickly that will have the robustness of commercial microscopes and many of these advantages that people will be very interested in.
Great, thank you, Wesley. I think this was a terrific talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the invitation.
Thank you, Wes.
And before we close, next week we will be hosting Dr. Michael Angelo from Stanford, a colleague of mine from also Stanford, and he will be talking about MIBI, multiplexed ion beam imaging technology. It's a method for proteomic imaging of about 35 to 40 markers at a time using isotope-based labeling and another machine that they actually custom made and commercialized recently. And we look forward to seeing you guys. And then this is all it for this week, and have a nice weekend.
Cool.
Yeah. Thank you all.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.